الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي خلق الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته وبتد بالصخور ميدان أرضه ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم سيما الحجة بقية الله في الأرضين روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه فداء السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So a few months back I was coming out of IEC Islamic Education Center in Maryland and I had my baba on and I was driving, I went to this gas station to fill out my tank and as I was doing so, a lady comes to me and asks me, wow, what a beautiful dress you have. Where did you get it from? And I told her I got it from Qom, and I was explaining for her, I was thinking that the meaning that my dress had in Qom, which was a sign for people who had any questions regarding Islam, that meaning has totally changed. Now, in Potomac, Maryland, in the gas station when I'm standing, this lady is thinking about everything except that this is a sign for asking Islamic questions, that if she has any Islamic questions, she can come to me. I think this has happened for many of us, that you do something back home has a meaning. You come here, you go to grocery store, you go to gas station, it has totally different meaning. This is the question that we want to talk about it. When some of the rituals that we have, some of the customs that we have back home, because of time, because of place, because of circumstances, because of context, lose its core meaning, what do you do then? Do you continue convincing people and teaching everyone, hey, you need to respect this, you need to know that this is a sign for Islam, or you would go some sort of like something teaching in sometimes and changing in sometimes else? So what do you do in these circumstances? So the question that I want to deal today is the question that if we have, how about if we had Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam instead of in 7th century Hijaz, if we had Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam 21st century US, what would have been different? What are the things that Prophet Muhammad would do differently? Or is there anything that he would do differently? So these are the questions that we want to talk about. And when we come to this, it's the question of change, the question of stability and change, the question of are ahkam of Islam, are they changing at all? Or they has to remain the same always as it was before. If you say it is changing, so how do you go with the hadith that we have, halal Muhammad and halalun, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad ila yawm al-qiyamah wa haramuhu haram ila yawm al-qiyamah. the what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made haram is gonna stay haram forever, and what he made permissible is gonna stay permissible forever. So if you say it is changing, how do you deal with these question, with these ahadiths? And if you say these are not changing, how do you deal with the ahkam which is not working in the society? So these are the questions that we want to talk about it today. And what I want to talk about, I want to say that change has been always part of the Islamic faith itself. Is not something that we are trying to import to faith from somewhere else. It is something organic from our own sources. It is something that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was teaching Maaz when he was sending him to Yemen. It is something that Imam Ali alayhi salam was teaching Malik when he was sending Malik to where?
Egypt.
So the question would be, if Imam Ali alayhi salam wanted to send Malik instead of to Egypt, if he wanted to send him to US, how Malik would respect some of the culture that already exists in this country, and what are the cultures that he's going to change it? So this is a very important question about how Islam is able to coexist with other people and how we are able to navigate our way forward, right? So these are the questions that we want to talk about. And let's go before me talking about different answers. Let me talk about some of the ahadith and some of the changes that has happened through the history in fiqh. Okay, so I talk a little bit about these changes that has happened, and then I tell you three different ways that Imam Ali alayhi salam and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was dealing with the culture in their context. So three different ways that Prophet dealt with the culture which already existed in Hijaz in 7th century. Three different ways that Imam Ali alayhi salam was dealing with the cultures and rituals that already existed during his time when he was in Kufa. Okay? So the question would be, how Islam is dealing with the culture which exists in US when it comes to US, right? So before that, let me give you a few examples of these changes which happened which happened in fiqh. Probably you all have heard of the change in fatwa about checks. Okay, anyone didn't hear of it? Like when Imam Khomeini gave his fatwa about the playing chess is permissible. So you know it was haram, but again it was not haram in the sense that he is changing a hukm of Islam. There are two different hukm. There are two different types of hukm in Islam. Some are thawabat. Thawabat are the ahkam which are not changing. Those are the core values. Those are the core things which are not changing. Those are the fruit itself which is not changing. And if you need the fruit, you need to peel off the skin to reach to that core. So that core is not changing at all. So what when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying halal, this is a hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, when he says halal Muhammadin halalun ila yawm al-qiyamah, what he means that whatever was permissible at the time of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is gonna stay permissible forever, he means only the thawabat, only that core part, but that the skin, but the surface is changing, and it's okay to change. So let me give you let me read for you the hadith that Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is talking about chess, right? If any one of you see this hadith, he's gonna say, of course it is haram. So bay'u shatranj haram wa aklu thamanihi suht wa ittikhazuha kufr wa la'ibu biha shirk wa salamu ala allahi biha ma'siyah wa ma'siyatun kabiratun mubiqa wal kha'idhu fi yadi fi fiha يده كالخائز يده في لحم الخندير لا صلاة له حتى يغسل يده. It's a very long hadith which says selling chess is haram, playing with it is kufr, and it's shirk, and saying salam to the person who is playing it is ma'siyah, ma'siyatun kabira. And when the person is touching his hand, like if you are touching the chest itself, it's like touching the lahm al khanzir, okay? Touching the meat of pork. And la salat Allah, you're not able to pray until you wash your hand. And it says it's like having zina, continues, when you continue the hadith, with mahram in Kaaba. So let's see what, like, this is the hadith that we have. So how come we have this hadith, and it's not only one hadith, it's a group of ahadith which are talking about that this is haram. And at the same time, you see our ulama are coming and saying, especially Imam Khomeini, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi, coming and saying this is halal. You need to have a lot of courage to come to give a fatwa against this hadith. Why? Because the faqih comes to the point of saying chess does not have the meaning that it had before. Exactly like the story that I told you about my qaba, that this didn't have the meaning in the gas station that like the meaning that it had in Qom, right? So the meaning behind it changed and made the hukm to change. Okay? So this is only one example. Chess is only one example. How many of you remember, like, say, having TV was haram? How many of you remember that wearing jeans was haram? How many of you remember that some sort of musics were haram? How many of you remember that, still, even wearing the clothes which had these sort of, how do you say the
collar?
Yeah. No, the yakaron, yeah. So this part, so the different way of dressing was different, was haram in many different societies. Okay, so even the concept of Darul Kufr and Darul Islam. So US, Europe, for a long time was named Darul Kufr, okay? Meaning that it was haram, according to some of our scholars, to migrate to them and go to them, right? But that change happened, the transition from Darul Kufr to Darul Tabligh. From Dar al-Kufr to Dar al-Da'wah. Dar al-Kufr to Dar al-Da'wah. Now our scholars, our ulama are talking about Dar al-Da'wah, the house to go and preach about Islam. So you see that this transition happening from Dar al-Kufr to Dar al-Da'wah, Darwin house, right? So all of these changes are happening. Again, the reason for this is not that the ahkam of Islam are changing, is that the meaning of things are changing. One day having tie is a sign of being Christian, tomorrow is not a sign of being Christian. One day a dress is only for ladies, so it's haram for men. Tomorrow that becomes a common dress and it's not haram. So the things are changing, not that the core mean, not the core meaning of ahkam. So let me go to the question again and see how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how Imam Ali alayhi salam were dealing with some of the rituals and some of the customs that already existed in their societies. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes to a society with many different customs. Right now, Islam comes to U.S. with many different customs. U.S. has already, before Islam enters into it, right? Before Islam comes, U.S. has a lot of customs. Before Islam comes to Iran, Iran had a lot of customs. Before Islam starts in Hejaz, Hejaz itself had a lot of customs. So the question would be how Islam is dealing with these customs. What are the things that changing? What are the things that are not changing? So Islam dealt with in with these customs, with these rituals in three different ways. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with them in three different ways. Some of them he just confirmed them. He said, "Okay, I agree with these, and it's with these customs that existed in his time." In Hijaz. An example for that would be Ashhur al-Haram, Zilqa'da, Zilhajjah, Muharram, and Rajab. So this was a good ritual that Arab, they were not fighting in these months. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is good, this needs to stay. And he is Shari, according to many of our scholars. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself is Shari too. He can order, and we have to follow because Ati'ullah wa Ati'ur Rasul. So that's a different topic. If there was question on that, we can touch upon that as well. So this is one example. Ashhur al-Haram, the Haram, the forbidden month, that you are not able to fight in that. So this custom existed before, and Prophet confirmed that. The and it's actually in the Quran, it says, Inna iddata shuhuri inda Allahi ithna ashara shahran fi kitabillah yawma khalaqa as-samawat wal-ard. Okay? So, and then it says, Minha arba'atun hurum. Four remind them are forbidden. So this is an example of when Prophet just confirmed what existed before. Okay. The other one, the second category is when Prophets are rejecting. Okay, rejecting a ritual. So for example, they were about the custom of burying. If a father had if I had a baby girl, okay, it was a shame for me, and the custom was that people were asking, it was like kind of a pressure for me to bury my daughter because of the shame that I was feeling for the community, for myself, right? So of course Prophet rejected this, and rejected this as an example. So the third one, which I think we need to talk more about it, is when he is not rejecting and he is not confirming. He is reforming it. He is changing it. He accepts some part of it and he rejects some part. Right? So the example for this one would be Idda. So Idda, which is the period that you cannot get married after divorce, this has existed before Islam. This was a custom that was a practice in Hijaz before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what he did not agree with that. He did not reject that. He changed some aspects of it. So it was a year. He changed it to 4 months. So he changed some of it. So the other example would be tawaf. Okay. So doing tawaf was a custom, was a ritual, was a practice before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and before Islam. But as it is in the Quran, they were doing tawaf naked. Okay, it's he changed some aspects of it, and he didn't change other aspects of it. So these are three different ways that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the culture which already existed in Hijaz. So let's talk now about what happened when Islam came to Iran. That was about Islam in Hijaz. So the same story happened when Islam came to Iran. So for example, and you all know about Nowruz, right? The new year, it's coming in two weeks, right? So this was a custom that existed before Islam, and Iranians were practicing it for a long time. So this was a custom existed, how Islam dealt with it, how Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam dealt with it. So did he rejected the whole thing, or did he accepted the whole thing? No, it was an example of what? It was an example of the last one, which is reform, which is changing some aspects of it and saving some aspects of it. The other one was Sijda Bedar in Iran. If you have heard of Sijda Bedar, which is number 13, which they go out because on the day 13th of the first month of year, because they believed that number 13 is not good, okay, and they were going out because they were afraid of a punishment or something bad happening to them. So this practice existed before, okay. But again, Islam did not reject it. Our ulama did not reject the whole thing. What they did, they changed it. So now it is being called as, anyone knows what they are calling it? They're calling it the Nature Day. Okay? It's Nature Day. Why? Because you go out, nature has rights, and you have to pay the rights of nature, and you have to respect the nature, and it's a good day to talk about environment, to talk about the rights that Islam, that is in Islam about environment. So in this day, you see all of these ahadiths which are talking about the rights of nature. Why this is haram to break, to walk on a grass without any purpose. Why this is haram to break a branch of a tree without any purpose. Why it is haram to take wudu with water if there is a plant here and the plant needs water. So it's haram to take wudu with this water because the plant needs water. So you see all of these ahadiths, I mean, if the plant needs water and there is not enough water, I think the example is clear, right? I'm not saying it always you need to water the plant and do tayammum. No. So you see all of these ahadiths being repeated on that day because of the change which happened. The custom was about number 13 bringing bad chance, and now they changed it to Nature Day, a day to talk about environment. So what you see here is happening in Iran is using the customs that already existed before Islam and saving some aspects of it and rejecting other aspects of it. So some of the things that is, that was existed, some of the custom what that was existed before Islam in Iran, but Islam totally rejected that, and our ulama totally rejected that, is the story of Chorshanbe Suri, if you've heard of. Chorshanbe Suri is the Wednesday before the New Year, which, like, they make a lot of fire and they jump over the fire and they say stuff like, I don't know, I mean, we used to practice it before. So during the year, our ulama came and said, well, there is no good aspect in this practice, so you need to reject the whole thing. So what you see in all of these examples happening, both in Hijaz and then in Iran, and actually in Misr, in Egypt. So when Imam Ali alayhi salam sent Malik to Egypt, you know this is the letter number 31 in Nahj al-Balagha. Go and read it. So Imam Ali alayhi salam orders Malik and he says, Malik, when you go there, don't change everything. He says, when you go there, people already have good culture. People already have good practice. People already have good customs that you may be able to use. So he says, وَأَشْئِرْ قَلْبَكَ الرَّحْمَةَ لِلرَّعِيَّةِ. And he continues, this is the same phrase that you all have heard about. People are two different types. Some of them are your brother in deen. Some of them are similar in creation. So you need to be nice with everyone. And then he says, watch out that you are not able to change everything that you see there. See what aspects of those practices are good, save them. And what aspects of those practices are not good, reject them. So you see that how different when Islam enters into different countries, when how Islam deals with the practices and that existed in that country before. So now the question would be, if Islam enters in US, what are the customs that Islam is going to change here? What are the customs that Islam is not changing? In another way, when you come to a new country from your background, okay, from your own country, what are the things that you thought this is Islam, but that was not actually Islam? That was only a culture that you were practicing back home, okay? So what are the things that you are allowed to take with you because those are Islamic? And what are the things that you are not allowed to take with you because those are part of the cultures? Okay, so this is the thing that we want to talk about it now. We want to talk about, like, back home I was practicing many things. What are the good things about it and what are the bad things about it? Now I'm coming here to US, what are the things that I am able to practice? What are the things that needs to be the visible sign of me, okay, as a Muslim? And what are the things that shouldn't be visible sign of me as a Muslim? Let me give you an example. So whenever we are talking about, let's say Muslims, okay, in US, can we say the first thing that comes to the mind of people are that Muslims are helping their neighbors? Their visible sign for Muslims in US is that they are very helpful to other people. Is that right? No. But is that Islamic? Yes, of course, right? So when we are talking about visible signs, we are talking about what are the things from Islam that we need to save and make it more visible. What are the signs from Islam that we think those are Islamic, but actually those are not Islamic, those are just culture, and we probably need to change them. So is the question clear now? Is that clear? So let's go to our tables now. And so we want to talk about first back home, okay? Some of the customs, some of the practices that we had back home that was good. And some of the practices that we had back home, but it was not good. You can, the papers that you have it on your tables are helping you to talk about different subjects. You can talk about some of the customs regarding marriage, regarding the way you dress, regarding the rights of women, regarding respecting elders, regarding whatever comes to your mind that you see different here and there. And then we come here and we find, inshallah, in the second phrase, we talk about the things that need to be added as our identity. Is that clear? I come to each table and explain more. So if it's clear, let's go and talk on our table. We'll have 20 minutes to talk, and make sure to write down, because from each table, someone is going to explain what they talked about in their tables.